Yeah. Such an exciting weekend for us, such an awesome weekend for our church, because this weekend is baptism weekend. Come on. Yeah, and if you don't know what baptism is simply a public expression of a life surrendered to Jesus. You know, baptism isn't an act of salvation, but it's simply a response from salvation. And these people today, they made Jesus the king over their life. They've accepted his grace, his mercy, and his love, and today before their church, before the world, they're declaring that they're forever changed by Jesus, that they belong to him. And so the way that we do baptisms here is there's a baptismal setup outside and there's a camera out there, and the live feed is coming into this room. It'll be up on the screens so we get to witness and partake in that together. But the other awesome part is that there's a speaker outside with the audio from this room so they can hear us as we're praising and as we're worshiping alongside them. You know, the Gospel of Luke says that all the heavens rejoice when even one sinner repents and comes home. And that's the song, that's the celebration that we get to join in together today. So when they come up out of that water, we're going to give the loudest shout, the loudest cheer, the loudest praise, because our God is so worthy and deserving. Amen? All right, so on the count of three, we're going to give it a try and then we're going to go for it. Ready? 1, 2, 3. I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was not till I met. I was breathing, but
Hey everyone, my name's Tyler and welcome to Rock Point. If this is your first time here with us, we'd love to know. Stop by the New Here Start Here table in the courtyard to say hi and learn more about how you can get connected. While you're here with us today, we encourage you to take out your smartphone and type in rockpoint.io. Here you can follow along with the sermon, take notes, keep track of upcoming events, join a group or a serving team, and sign up for We Are Rock Point.
Promotion weekend is happening on May 18th and 19th. This is where students will attend the service appropriate to whatever grade they'll be moving into this fall. If you have youth going into sixth grade in the fall, they'll be going into the middle school area. If you have any questions or are looking for more clarity, visit rockpointchurch.com/promotionweekend.
Our foster care ministry is hosting a duffel bag drive to collect items to donate to the placement center. These bags are given to foster kids that most often leave their home with nothing or a trash bag with some of their belongings. Over the next couple weeks, we'll be collecting items to fill these bags with. For more information and a list of needed items, visit rockpoint.io and stop by the tent in the courtyard on your way out.
Our mission here at Rock Point is to point people to Jesus by loving them like Jesus. Thank you for being a part of this by living intentionally and through the faithful giving of your tithes and offering. While we don't collect the offering in service, we do have boxes near all the exits, both in the worship center and in the lobby. You can also give online at rockpoint.io. Let us know if we can help you in any way while you're here with us today, and make sure to connect with us on rockpoint.io and on social media to stay up to date with everything here at Rock Point.
Good morning. How awesome were the baptisms? Isn't that cool? It's always awesome, always awesome, always awesome. Hey, something else is awesome. We have these new shirts. Love them like Jesus. And we sell these in our swag shop out here if you want them. But I was such a good salesperson last night, we sold them all already. So if you want to get, you can still get, they ordered a whole bunch more. So you can get them. It's just, I'm just too good at sales, sorry. But no, I modeled it so well. So there you go. But anyways, hey, we're in this series, Chasing Bigfoot, talking about parenting. And what we've really been talking about is this idea of some of the myths that just persist. They persist about how we can parent and how we can be the perfect parent. And we've been kind of just taking those myths apart. And really how we've been looking at it is this idea that at the heart of the heart of parenting starts in the heart of a parent. So really, we've been unpacking some of these heart issues because some of the myths we grab onto, the things we pour into our kids and pour into their hearts, usually is just coming from our own heart, our own life. So we got to deal with our hearts. So the nice thing about that is if you're new here or you're just checking it out and you don't have kids, you don't know what a kid is, you wished you didn't have kids, you try to block it from your, whatever it is, you're going to get a lot out of this because it's really the messages we're looking at, talk to us first. It's just what do we pass on to our children? So it's excellent that way. So, but you know, we just did some baptisms. Speaking of being in water, I was thinking back with my own children. I go, how many of you taught your kids how to swim? How many that was just a joy-filled experience? I mean, I taught all of our kids how to swim. And you know, there's different varied degrees of difficulty in doing that, but certain personalities make it a little bit more difficult. And I'll give you one guess as to which one of my children was the more difficult one. The boy, Jaden. And the problem was we showed him how to swim. He knew how, but he just wouldn't take the floaties off and actually go in the water and swim. And it was very difficult. And he would cause a fit. And we didn't own a pool. So when we're trying to do this, we're at our little community pool. So there's always a bunch of people around. And that's always awkward when your kid's freaking out and fighting with you. And it just looks weird. And you're like, how many people are like videotaping this? They're going to send it to CPS or whatever. But one of the things is he would just get really upset. And it was really difficult for his mom because she would just, okay, fine, I'm not going to try to get you to do this. So, you know, he's sitting there still wearing his floaties. And finally, I had to go, Jaden, you're in college now. You have to take the floaties off. No, it wasn't that bad. But we're sitting there one day, and he had gotten really worked up. I wasn't there yet. I came over to the pool. She's like, hey, did you get him to try to, he knows how to swim. But we need him to know that he knows how to swim in case something happens if we're ever not around. right? And so he just went in. I go, well, did you just force him in? He goes, I'm not going to do that. He was freaking out. There's people around. It's embarrassing. All right, let me talk to him. I get over to the pool. There's all this crowd around. I come. I go, hey, Jaden. Karina, like, hey, why do you want to get? And he's like, no, I don't want to do it. And I go, okay. And I just stopped. I said, hey, Jaden, do you trust me? Do you trust your dad? And he goes, yeah, daddy, I trust you. I go, okay, remember I said that. And then I grabbed him and I threw him in the deep end. I just picked him up and chucked him in, right, not by the side, right out in the middle. I like shot putted him out there. And he's like, ah! And he pops up and I was like, ah! And you know, it's a little bit concerning to the people around us, what I just did. And then he's like getting all mad, and how many of you that kind of is disconcerting to you? That freaks, you're like, that seems sad. That's a little bit, I asked that question last night, my wife raised her hand. Because that's what it was like in that moment. She's like, what did you just do? And he's like sitting there struggling. And next thing you know, he just started swimming. Swam right to the side. Staring at me with that look of, this is something to add to the list when I talk to the counselor someday. And as he swam, he got down, he's yelling. He's like, why did you do that? I said I trusted you. I said, why? Why? And I finally said, Jaden, stop. You're asking the wrong question. He goes, what do you mean? You shouldn't be talking about why. He goes, really? I go, yeah, you should be talking about what? He goes, what do you mean? I go, what did you just do? You just swam. And my son, this is what I love about him. He's like, yeah, that's right, cool. And then he turned around, dove back in, and started swimming. Like all out swimming, just like he was a fish. And it was just that moment. And here's why I share that story is because parenting was so hard. No, was because this is the thing I want to talk about today. It's a difficult one. This is one of the myths that we're going to unpack today that it's easy to buy into because it feels right. It just feels right. And to do the truth the right way can sometimes feel very uncomfortable. Because what's happening is with him is if you feel kind of discombined, like, man, I can't believe you did that to your kid, then you might really wrestle with the myth we're going to talk about today. Because here's the big idea, the concept I want us to land before I tell the myth and the truth. And that's simply this. Instead of protecting my children from everything, I need to prepare them for anything. That's really the goal. See, Sunday, if we take a parenting model that says, I need to protect them from everything, the problem with that sounds good, but if you make that the goal, if you make that the number one to protecting them from everything, now this, what did I say? Don't hear what I'm not saying. I'm not saying reckless disregard. Hey, Bill said I can just throw some Cheerios on the floor and my 9-month-old will be fine. I can lock the door and come back in 6 hours. It's not what I'm saying. I didn't say you don't protect your kids. But if you try, if you think the goal is nothing, the number one goal is protecting them, what did we say last week? What's an idol? An idol is not necessarily a bad thing. Oftentimes our idols are a good thing that we make the main thing. And protecting our children is not the number one goal. We're not supposed to protect them from everything. We're supposed to prepare them for anything. And that's really the heart of the myth. When I go the too far the other way, I buy into this myth, and that myth is simply this. Is where's the myth? Put the myth up. Boom. My child's safety is my top concern. That's the myth. People say that's number one. Like you have a kid, you think, I need to keep it alive is basically the number one. Now, and I'm not saying that's not a concern, but if you make that all you want to do, because here's the problem, that safety myth morphs as they get bigger. It becomes, I just need to keep them physically safe, to then you start to realize I need to keep them emotionally safe. Then you start moving, and I need to keep them financially, relationally safe. And you start, that word safety actually morphs into security. And it all becomes about, I need to teach them safety, security. You know, you gotta keep them safe. You gotta have a good relationship. I protect everything. Gotta make sure they get the good grades. I'll go do most of the work for them. I'll put if you're doing this is, when my kids were little and they had to do a little project, especially in like kindergarten, first grade, and my kids' project would look like horrible. And then I'd walk up and all the other kids, it looked like they built the replicas of the Eiffel Tower. And I guarantee you, my kid was the only one that actually did their project themselves. If it looks like it was done by an architectural firm, that's because you did it for them, mom and dad. Trust me. And that doesn't help them. And so that idea that safety morphs into, yeah, you want to keep them safe. Yes, I want them to be secure. Yes, I want them to have a good education. Yes, I want them to be able to get a nice job, have a nice family, live in a nice neighborhood. I'm not saying those are wrong, but if you make that the goal, it changes the way you act, and you actually can disconnect preparing your kids for anything. There was a study NPR just put out that compared 18 to 34-year-olds from 1960 to now. Twice as many 18 to 34-year-olds live at home now than they did in 1960. They haven't moved out. 34-year-olds. And that when they did the study, it's not just because the economic things have changed. It's that more 18 to 34-year-olds are not prepared to live on their own. And which is funny is because what we do in a parenting style is we protect at all costs. Safety, security, safety, security. They're not prepared to be able to engage in that on their own. That's the problem. So what's the truth then? If we're not supposed to protect them from everything but prepare them from anything, how do I go about doing that? What is the truth? And the truth is this: trusting Jesus rather than chasing safety should be my top concern. That should be my top concern. Because if you trust Jesus, you go down his path. It's not a formula for perfect parenting, it's a pathway to take them down. And if you teach them how to trust and how to and model the way Jesus parents us, and we use that model with our kids, that's what will help us. That's what will get us on the right path. And like I said, again, this is why this is great, because what I'm going to talk about right now needs to come in our heart first. We have to choose that too. You got to ask yourself, what are you chasing after right now? Are you chasing safety and security? You might be a Christian, but there's this twist that my number one goal is safety and security. Jesus is just the mode that I'm going to get there. You understand that? You could say, I'm going to use God to get my goal. And that's not how it works. If I'm going to follow the Lord, I need to choose to trust him first. That's the goal. Trusting and being connected to him should be the goal. And this is why this is important. You don't have to be a parent. This is going to be powerful. But if you are a parent, what I really want you to land is not, before you think about what you're going to do with your kids, you got to ask yourself the question of everything we're looking at, go, do I do this? Because parenting is a pathway, not a formula. They have to follow you. So the passage we're going to look at to take this part, what does that look like, trusting Jesus rather than chasing safety? It looks like we're going to be in a passage in Matthew chapter 14. It's a very well-known passage. It's where Jesus walks on water. But Jesus isn't the only one that walks on water. A guy named Peter does as well. And we're going to learn from this interaction about what can we learn as people, but also as parents, when it comes to trusting Jesus. And what do I need to engage in trusting Jesus? And then by extension, if I'm a parent, what am I supposed to be passing on to my kids? What am I supposed to be pouring into them? What path am I supposed to be showing them? And if I buy into this myth, you can be actually not preparing your kids for much of anything. And it becomes more about our own insecurities, our own fears, rather than trusting Jesus. So here we are. This passage is in, like I said, Matthew 14, starting in verse 22. And I'm going to read a little bit, talk it through, and then I'm going to make, there's 5 points I'm going to make in this passage that talk about what we need to learn about ourselves in parenting and when it comes to trusting Jesus. And so it starts in verse 22. Immediately after this, Jesus, after this was, he just fed the 5,000. So they saw this incredible miracle. And now, right after that, it says, Jesus insisted that his disciples get back into the boat and cross to the other side of the lake, the Sea of Galilee, Lake Gennesaret. And while he sent the people home, after sending them home, he went up into the hills by himself to pray. Night fell while he was there alone. Meanwhile, the disciples were in trouble far away from land, for a strong wind had risen and they were fighting heavy waves. I don't know if you've ever been to the Sea of Galilee. I've been out on a boat twice, and it's a pretty good sized lake, but it's not massive. But where it sits down in and the way the mountains are around it, it creates these pressures where winds can dive down on it, and it can create massive waves and storms, like dangerous, especially in the boats they used back then. It could wipe you out. And so it says they're in trouble. That means it's a pretty bad storm because most of them were fishermen. They grew up on this lake. They understood how it works. And basically they've gotten out in the middle and they've gotten stuck with the winds and the waves and they're not getting very far. So they're in trouble. And it says about 3 o'clock in the morning, Jesus came toward them walking on water. That must have been an interesting sight. I've been out there and I've looked at it and I've sat in the middle of this lake and I try to imagine if it was stormy. I go, what would that be like to just see somebody checking his Fitbit? And they've been rowing for hours all day and this guy's just walking right up to him through the storm. Well, look what it did to them. When the disciples saw him walking on the water, they were terrified. In their fear, they cried out, it's a ghost! You know, that's kind of a cool, that's not one of the 5 points, but just for free, I'll throw this in. That's kind of interesting how when we get into a storm in life and we're struggling or in trouble and Jesus comes close, how often do you get afraid of Jesus? He's the answer, and yet we're terrified. You're struggling right now. Some of you are sitting like, I'm struggling as a parent, and he's going to tell me I got to chase Jesus. You're like, this sounds scarier than the problem I'm in. And they're like, it's a ghost! And yet, verse 27 says, but Jesus spoke to them at once. Don't be afraid. Take courage. I am here. And then verse 28, the way my brain works, is kind of an interesting verse to me, because then Peter called out to him, Lord, if it's really you, tell me to come to you, walking on the water. So the cool part is, Peter sees Jesus. He's like, that is so awesome. They were in trouble. They were filled with fear. They're terrified that he's a ghost. And all of a sudden, Peter realizes, Jesus, I want to do that. You know, he wants to go do it too. But what's really funny, the way my brain works, is he goes, if it's really you, tell me to come. If it's really you, that doesn't sound smart. I mean, has Peter never seen a horror movie, a ghost movie of any kind? I mean, if it's really an evil spirit, it's going to say, yeah, I'm Jesus. Come on, step out of the boat and into the water. Sorry, that has nothing to do with the sermon. It's just weird to me. But the cool part is Peter, in the midst of this storm, they were terrified and in trouble, but all of a sudden Jesus identifies that he's here. And the first thing Peter decides he wants to do is, wow, I want to go where you're going. So then verse 29, Jesus says, yes, come, Jesus said. So here's the first point I want to make out of this. When it comes to our own hearts, if we're going to choose to trust Jesus rather than chase safety in our lives, safety and security, the first thing we got to do is when Jesus calls, you obey. When Jesus calls you out, you obey. When he says, hey, come, you obey. Now, I know what you're saying there. It's like, whoa, you said it's about Jesus giving me a command, calling me to do something, but didn't Peter offer first? Yeah, he did. But there's a difference between that emotional feeling, like, wow, that experiential, that moment you experience that feeling of, I want that. I want to go where Jesus is. In the midst of the storm, I really want. But there's a difference between that and then when Jesus says, okay, come. Because you realize he said, I want to, and Jesus said, then okay, get out of the boat. And you realize that's two different things. We do that a lot, and this is the problem. This is really a fine point of, this is where we can subtly really not prepare our kids, especially when it comes to trusting Jesus. We might go to church all the time. We might do this stuff, but here's the thing. I think we really have this struggle in our culture, and I struggle with this as well, is that I substitute an emotional experience for actual obedience. You ever done that? Like you have this emotionally, it could be a camp, it could be, you know, somebody came back from man camp, and like, man, you guys were challenged, and a lot of you got really, really, really emotional. And part of you says, you know, I gotta go back, I gotta be a better husband, I gotta be a better father, I gotta be better this. Well, you haven't done any of that yet. All you experienced was that moment where you said, wow, I want that. I want that. The problem is what comes next. Jesus says, okay, then get out of the boat. And now you got to take an actual step of obedience. And there is a difference. And we often assume one means that. Because when you come to, like, you can come into church here and you can have this incredibly emotional moment. Like, wow, that powerful, that sermon, that illustration, that song, that moment, that touched me, that grabbed me. And you're crying and you have this emotional experience. But that's the first step. That's a good thing. That's like, hey, I've seen the light. The door is open. I've seen what Jesus has and I want it. I do. I want it. But you then have to, Jesus says, get out of the boat. Come, what do I need to obey him in? How do I need to honor his word? What do I need to choose to do to show that I trust Jesus? Because the problem is we get so emotionally invested in the emotion of the moment that then we walk out here and we feel like, wow, I really got closer to God right then. And we are exhausted from the emotion. But there's no actual obedience. It's not real. Let me give you an example that'll probably explain it. And I'm just going to tell you, this is embarrassing to me, okay? This is how much I love you guys. I'm going to tell you something very embarrassing, all right? So this better work. No. I went and saw the new Avengers movie, Endgame. And I've seen it twice already. My son has seen it 3 times. My one daughter's twice. I mean, I think the Bush family accounts for $1 billion of the $2 billion it's already made. But I love those movies. I love those stories. I love superhero characters. And I grew up, Captain America was always my favorite superhero. So it's kind of an emotional thing to me because my whole childhood, I really, 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 really love it. And the movie was very good. I'm not going to spoil any of the plot points, but it was really good. But it was actually had some very emotional moments in it. So I really loved it. And I had an emotional experience. Like, there's times when you cry. There's times when you laugh. There's times when you're doing both at the same time. And so then I left. But I saw it in the afternoon. And my daughter, who hadn't seen it yet, who loves these movies that I usually talk about, she's at school when I get home. She hasn't even seen it yet. My son's not around. And so I come home, and my wife's the only one there. And she's seen some of the movies, but she just doesn't get it. She's not that way. But I go, I have to talk to somebody. If you haven't figured out, I like to talk. And so I was like, I have to talk this out a little bit. This is a moment. It was so expensive. So I was describing the movie to her. And here comes the embarrassing part. As I was telling her some of it, I started to cry. And then she's like, are you crying? And I'm like, no. No? I'm like, yes, I'm totally crying. And it was kind of embarrassing. But yet she could tell it emotionally affected me. But here's what I'm trying to say. I had all the feels, but none of it was reals. I had all the feels, but nothing was for reals. And that's really what we do sometimes with our faith. We come here to the movie. And we see the stories, and we experience it, and we're like, I want that. And we emotionally engage with it, and we have the emotions, and we have all the feels, but we haven't done anything for reals. Does that make sense? Here's the problem. That's what you're teaching your kids. You are actually planting the seed for them to walk away from their faith. Because if you just teach them it's all about an emotional experience, what happens when they don't feel the emotion? They leave. You don't go to the movie that you don't like. And that's why so many of us in our culture bounce from church to church to church. Because you're like, hey, I liked that movie. That gave me all the good feel. But all of a sudden, it's just not grabbing me like it used to. But I heard that this church over here, they got this thing going on. I go, oh man, that music, the way that guy talked, he wasn't an idiot like that guy at Rock Point. And you start here, and then you get emotional again. And what we're doing is you're running for another emotional fix, another emotional fix, another emotion. Now, emotion is a good starting point. It got Peter willing to do something that the other 11 wouldn't do. But he still needed to hear the voice of the Lord say, okay, here's what you need to do then. What is it in your life that Jesus is saying, come, get out of the boat? What is it? For some of you, it's what you just saw in the beginning of the service, baptism. You believe in Jesus, but for some reason you won't get out of the boat and get in the water. If that's you, I challenge you, as Jesus said, when we're done with the service, walk out there and say, I want to get baptized. They can baptize you between the services. That's what I'm talking about. You see, the emotional experience has to then be followed up with actual obedience. What is Jesus saying you to get out of the boat on with your time? What is he saying to get out of the boat on with your money? See, because what you feel about this is what you are going to show your kids, no matter what you say to your kids. And if it's only an emotion and they don't have the emotion, then they're going to get this idea, this notion, there you go, it rhymes, that this whole Christianity thing is stupid. Or you'll teach them to do the same thing you do, which is not real. It's all the feels, but nothing for reals. Does that make sense? So that's the first thing. But then the other thing is, I want to read the next part of this verse. If you go on, he says, yes, come. So Peter went over the side of the boat and walked on water towards Jesus. How cool is that? He got to walk on water towards Jesus. But when he saw, But when he saw the strong wind and the waves, he was terrified and began to sink. He said, save me, Lord, he shouted. So when he went over, he decided to do it. He's going, and then all of a sudden he sees the wind and the waves. It's actually said he saw the wind. Can you see wind? It says he looked at Jesus, he was walking towards Jesus, but then he saw the wind and the waves and got terrified and began to sink. What happened? He was looking at Jesus, right? Well, if he saw wind and waves, what did he stop doing? He stopped looking at Jesus. He got distracted. He went back to being terrified like he was in the boat before Jesus showed up, like the disciples were, the rest of them, the other 11 were, when Jesus says, I'm here. They thought he was a ghost. And I guarantee he probably went back to what the other 11 were still thinking, because no one else offered to get out of the boat. No one else. They probably thought the safest place to be was the boat. They probably thought Peter was dumb. They probably said, don't do that. You should stay here. That sounds crazy. And yet he got out. But what happens? He stops looking at Jesus. So there's two points to be made here that I want to talk about. And I just want to say them both and unpack them. And then one is, you have to look for Jesus, but you have to continue to look to Jesus. As a follower and as a parent, that's what you need to show your kids. Look for Jesus in your life. But then as the storm gets bad, continue to look at Jesus. Look to him. Continue to walk towards Jesus no matter what. Don't let the storms distract you. Don't let the problem make you change the path. And really the second point with that is this idea that faith is really just one step at a time. Faith is always what's the next step. See, sometimes if you've done some great things and trust you, I got great faith, because you have this history of great faith. You realize your faith is defined as strong or weak based on what is the step right in front of you. There's not credit for past experience. At any given moment, you're either trusting Jesus or you're not. It's not like this meter where you're at 100% trust and now some things are going bad and so you've stopped trusting. But, you know, I'm still at 85%. I still got some juice left. It's either you are trusting or you're not. Faith is always, what is that next step? What is that next step? What is that next step? And the only way we're going to continue to do that in our own life and be able to show our kids and what we need to teach them is in every one of those steps, you have to keep looking for Jesus and looking to Jesus. Otherwise, we get distracted. And you know what's crazy about that is what he did is he started looking at the problem instead of the answer. How about you? In your own life, when problems get bad, what's your first temptation? Do you pull away from looking at Jesus? What I mean, like, stop coming to church. You know, I was in community, but life's kind of hard, so you isolate. You get away from it. You back off. You look. You start to try to figure out and make decisions that aren't really scriptural. You don't seek good, wise counsel. You just start. Why? And if someone says, hey, this isn't wise, maybe I was like, no, you don't understand. I got that. And then what is your usual, the complaint? How do you argue? The way you argue is usually you just emphasize the problem, but you don't understand. This is going wrong. This is going wrong. This is going wrong. This, you know what that is? You're looking at the problem, not the answer. That's what Peter, and we act that way. Guess what we're teaching our kids to do? To constantly worry and trust Jesus for the emotional moments, but when actual obedience comes, if the storm is bad enough, don't look to him. get fixated on the problem and make a decision based on that. Does that make sense? That's what he starts to do. He starts to sink. He starts to go down. But you know what? Failure isn't final. It isn't. Because, you know, Jesus doesn't let him drown. There's a difference between sinking and drowning. Now, right here, this is it. This is this moment. If you're a parent, this is what makes battling this myth so hard. When our kids sink, our hearts sink. And then we start looking at the problem. And then we get fixated on the drowning. And then we do whatever it takes to just rescue them. And the truth is, what did Jesus do? He didn't stop them from ever sinking. Think about it. He got distracted. He stopped having faith. He doubted. He started to look away. And Jesus didn't use his power to keep him fully walking on water while he did that. Think about it. What if he did? He's like, oh my God. But he's still walking on water. What would that have done to Peter's attitude about how life works? Think about it. If he didn't sink at all, even when he was fearful, he probably would have been like, look what I did. He got back and went, you guys suck, you know, pointing at the other disciples. Look what I did, man. I just walked on water. I'm like, Jesus, you know. He would not have experienced a little bit of the sinking. He needed to know that it was Jesus you got to look to, Jesus you got to trust. And if you look away, you're going to sink worse. And so basically, Jesus let him sink a little. You know why? Jesus will let him sink a little so the lesson will sink in. That's actually good. You should write that down. Put that on your refrigerator. Sometimes you got to let your kids sink in order for the lesson to sink in. They have to taste the failure. You have to let them fail. Because then they know when they fail, that realigns their faith. And the problem is so many of us parents, your kid, you won't let them sink at all. Sinking is bad. Failure of that kind, sinking failure is not final. Drowning is, but just sinking a little, that kind of failure is not final. That kind of failure can usually lead to greater faith, to greater success. You're better prepared because it showed them a path. And that's what makes this so hard, parents. That's why we end up with helicopter parents. But the problem with a helicopter parent is you're just sending your kid to hell. No copter, just hell. And you're gonna put yourself through hell. Get to the other side of helicopter. You know how many parents that helicopter parent their kid and their kids fail anyways, miserably bad, and they're not prepared for anything, and they blame everyone because you never let them sink a little, and now they turn on you? Wow, what a waste of your life. And what a deeper pain. If you don't let them sink, eventually they'll drown. That's the point. That's what Jesus does. He lets them sink, and he waits until he learns something. He waits till he looks back to Jesus and says, you have to save me. You see that? And that's a good principle for us as parents. Sometimes you got to let them sink a little, and hopefully you wait. You might, I'm not saying you don't let them drown. Like I said, Jesus didn't let them drown. You could be there. You can help your kids, but kind of wait till maybe they realize they're starting to go under and reach out. Now you can help them a little bit. Jesus didn't say, yeah, you had last faith. He didn't like stick them and push them under. What's that? I can't understand you. No, that doesn't sound like an apology to me. That's not what I'm saying. The problem is your kid sinks a little. And that's what's tough for us, right, moms? Right, dads? It's hard. I think that's why my dad worked so hard at constantly leaning into my sister and I with our Bush family motto, do hard things. He never said succeed. He just said do hard things. Because when you get really good at doing hard things, medium hard things become easy. If you never do anything hard, easy things are hard. Jesus was saying, hey, I'm challenging you. And he did. And he's like, hey, it's not failure. You can fail forward, or you can just fail. We need to teach our kids how to fail forward. And some of us struggle with that. Like I said, parenting starts in your heart. Many of you are chasing safety and security in your own life. You fear failure, so you won't try anything. You're like the other disciples. You won't even get out of the boat. Because look what Jesus says to Peter after he bails him out. He says, you know, where am I? Here we go. Save me, Lord. Jesus immediately reached out and grabbed him. See, he didn't let him drown. He helped him. But then he said, you have so little faith. Why did you doubt me? See, this is a teaching moment. He helped him, but Peter realized he had doubted. Peter realized he was sinking. Peter learned something from it. And when you hear him say, why did you doubt me? I have so little faith. You realize there's a difference between little faith and what the other disciples experienced in that moment, right? They experienced no faith. Little faith better than none. And it was a learning moment. He helped them then. That's what we need to be like as parents as well. But Jesus does it. We got to really to trust Jesus to step out in that step of faith. He goes, but why did you doubt me? And what he's saying is like, hey, you may have had this little bit of failure, but the other 11 are not exhibiting any faith at this moment. But what's so cool is his little bit of faith actually does inspire the disciples. Just like I said, mom and dad, you get out of the boat, even if you sink a little, that's gonna help your kids. Because look what happens. It says, when they climbed back into the boat, the wind stopped, then the disciples worshiped him. You really are the Son of God. Now they worshiped. So these last 2 points is if you see that, is he totally helped them. He challenged them. But it's this idea that, you know, after faith is simply taking the next step, but faith unleashes the supernatural. Getting out of the boat, and try, even though his faith wasn't perfect, it still unleashed the supernatural, the power of God. Some of you might be struggling, you know, I hear these stories, I hear this, I come to church, I believe in Jesus, but man, I don't see the power of God in my life. What's wrong? It could be that you just sit in the boat, and you do the same thing how you parent your kids. You're the parent that says, even if your kid wants to get out of the boat, no, wait, Jesus, don't trust Jesus. Jesus, you know what, I need a written explanation of exactly how this walking on water thing is gonna work before my kid goes and does that. And you know what, I need you to sign a waiver, Jesus, that guarantees, I need, it's like we act like we love our kids more than Jesus does. And we don't. We don't. Jesus knows what's better for your kids than you do. You know why? Because he knows what's better for us than we do. Jesus loves us better than we love ourselves. And so faith will unleash the supernatural. It really does. It's just hard. It's hard to let your kids do that. My youngest daughter turned 16. She got her driver's license a month ago. And you know, and that's scary, isn't it? Driving, teaching them how to drive. But when I'm teaching my daughter how to drive and I'm in the car, I'm not fearful for her life, I'm fearful for my life. But the fearful part, the scary part of letting them get out of the boat, letting them do, is that moment that all three of my kids have done it and I thought it'd get easier. This third one, I think it was the hardest because it's the baby. She came up and just 2 weeks ago, she walked up and said, Dad, can I take your car and go to my friend's house? She wanted to go to your house. and I had to take the keys out of my pocket and go, wow, this is the first time she's gonna drive away all by herself. Ah. As a dad, part of it is don't hurt my car. But there comes that moment. This is what makes it so hard. If I'm all about safety, I'm like, I don't want my kid to drive. Somebody's like, I hope they never drive. Why? Because all you're cared about is their safety. What are you gonna do, drive them to work when they're like 50 and you're like 70? He's like, at some point, if they're gonna live in this culture and have an actual job or kids or do something, they're going to have to be able to get in a car and drive away by themselves. You can prolong that as long as you want, mom and dad, but at some point, you gotta let go of that key. Boom. I get it. That was difficult for me. I want you to know, I'm not the guy that stands up here and makes it sound like I'm just a jerk. Oh, so easy. Just make your kids do it this way. I'm actually a huge softy. Ask my wife. I'm really more of the softy than she is. It's hard. I get it. But here's the two choices you have. What did the disciples do when they got back in the boat? They worshiped. You have a choice as a parent. You could worry or you can worship. That's the last point. Which one do you want to do? Which one are you teaching your kid to do? When life gets scary and doesn't feel safe or secure, what do you show your kids? Worry or worship? Do you look to the problem or do you stare at the answer? Jesus. This is the heart of parenting. This is the big rock. There's plenty of books out there on how do I get them to sleep through the night? How do I get them to do their homework? How do I get them to do that? There's lots of great advice on that. But none of that means anything if you don't get this right. If you don't get this right, that the idea is, hey, you can try to protect your children from everything, but in fact, if you do that, you won't really prepare them for anything. And that's what we need to do. Because you know why? When I try to protect them from everything, I've taken Jesus's place. And instead of becoming the steward of these children, I act like the savior of these children. And we're bad saviors. We can't even save ourselves. And when I act like the savior, I can distract my kids. And sometimes I resist that. Because deep in my heart, I think I love my children more than Jesus does, and that's not true. That's not true. The heart of parenting starts in the heart of the parent. What are you chasing? Are you chasing after security, safety? Is that why you're so with your kids? Because your own fears and your own securities are just bleeding into your parenting style. Do you want to trust Jesus and then show your kids the same path? Because here's the same funny thing. When I buy into this myth, whether I say it or not, I act like it's safer to be in the boat than to be walking on the water with Jesus. But think about this. It never said that Jesus kept the storm calm while they're in the boat. Weren't they in trouble and terrified? Waves crashing over? That didn't change. Here's the ironic twist, that when you try to, you stay in the boat because you think it's all about safety, you actually end up in an unsafe situation, an unsecure situation. Peter, even while he was sinking, standing in front of Jesus, was ultimately in a safer, more secure place than the other 11 were staying in the boat. That's the ironic twist of all of this. The very thing you're afraid of, you're creating if you parent that way. And I get it. It's difficult, it's hard. So I just want to tell you something from my own heart so you know that I'm with you on this, on why this is difficult. Just like I had to throw my son in the deep end. He just moved out about 2-3 weeks ago. And there was something about that that was even more difficult than my daughter moving out, because she got married, and so it's like she wasn't moving out on her own. She married a pretty decent guy, much smaller biceps than me, but he's a good man. Love you, man. I was confident in that. Still sad, but good. But he just moved out, and he's one of those guys that you got to let him sink a little. I'll be honest. He was here last night. It was crazy. I couldn't tell the story without crying. It was like Endgame all over again. But, man, he moved out because he was an intern here. It was all safe. But then he had this moment where he felt like, I think I need to get out of my dad's shadow. I need to spread my wings. I said, actually, you just need to stop coattailing off me, son. But no, but he and his mentors felt like it might be good for him because they've taken him as far as he can get. But it's like you said, he's not sinking. So he got to this point that not sinking, he almost wasn't learning anymore. So he had a chance to go work as a children's director in our church plant up in North Phoenix that I'm coaching them. And so now he's up there. So this is what you want to talk about. It's hard to not let your kids sink a little. I'm actually coaching his boss. And then he gets frustrated with stuff. And he goes to his mom. And then I hear about it. You want to talk about the temptation? I could walk in and tell us, you are an idiot. Here's what you need to do. But I can't. Because he's starting to sink a little. He even owned it. He said it. He's struggling. And he's actually said, man, I didn't realize how good Jeff and Logan and Steve-O were as leaders in my life till I have, you know, as he's trying to wrestle through and he's at a church that's brand new. They don't have a culture. He just assumed that the culture, he bragged about this church. He loves this church. He says, this church is full. People are so on fire. The people that volunteer. And he's like, it doesn't seem that way. And I'm not bagging on the church. It's because it's a new church. And now he came to me. And before, if I tried to coach him on something, he'd go, I get it, Dad, whatever, we get in a fight. But now he's like, I don't get this. I go, well, you know what's happening? It's because leadership, you're one of the only staff people. You're brand new. You're the first guy on the spot. You know how you get the culture you want in that children's ministry? He goes, what? I go, you have to build it. You were riding on other people sacrificing. So now we have a bunch of people that love this place. The children's ministry staff, the volunteers are awesome. You're the one that's going to have to build it. All of a sudden, that's a great realization. He's like, oh, that's more difficult than just getting up on stage and being able to wave my arms and act like an idiot like my dad does. You know, it's different to build it. I go, yeah, that's the part that was the hard part about starting a church. And we've had incredible conversations. Still freaking his mom out. She worries about every little, how's he going to afford this? How's he going to do that? Did they, you know, like, they didn't pay him on time. What's going on? You know, and all these, she's jumping. I go, you can't solve all of his problems. All you're doing is getting stressed, and that stresses me out. And that's when I draw a line. As long as it doesn't bother me, I don't care. No, just, well, maybe not totally. I'm just kidding. And it's hard. It's hard to watch your kids sink a little. But man, lessons are sinking in now. Lessons are sinking in. And when you trust Jesus, it's so cool. Something just happened. Like one of my wife's biggest worries, his car is a piece of crud. But he's serving Jesus. So he doesn't make much. And she's like, how can we fix it? I go, I can't fix it. Just pray. Worry or worship. Someone walked up to me this morning and says, I have a car I want to give away. Do you know someone that needs one? I go, well, I just might. When you trust Jesus, you can see the supernatural. It just works weird, but it is hard. Father God, I thank you, Lord. I thank you that you love us more than we love us, and that you love our children more than we can even love our children. So Lord, I just pray that we could just chase after you and trust you instead of chasing safety. And that, Lord, that would show in our parenting. That, Lord, instead of trying to protect our children from everything, we would learn how to prepare them for anything. And that comes from pointing them to you. Lord, as our mission statement says, as my shirt says, may we point our kids to Jesus by loving them like Jesus. That is my prayer for me and everyone in this room. And Lord, and I just specifically want to pray for any parent in here that's struggling right now, that you would help give them grace and strength through that storm. Lord, I want to pray for any single parent in this room, because that just doubles the stress and doubles the problem. It is so difficult to do this with two parents, let alone to be one. So Lord, I pray that you will give them grace and strength. Lord, I pray for any foster parents in this room, because it's complicated to try to guide a child on a path that might have been set on a path that these parents had nothing to do with. And then finally, Lord, I pray for any parents that are longing to be parents, but they're struggling. They haven't been able to become parents. And I know how it feels. You come into a parenting series and it feels like they're just being reminded over and over and over again of something they long for but don't have. Lord, I pray that you would bless them, give them strength. And if it's in your will, give them a child. But Lord, I pray through all of this, instead of worrying, we would choose to worship. And I pray this all in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen.